Let's bless his holy name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your
heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, beloved. So good to be gathered together this morning to worship and praise Christ our Savior. On behalf of the entire Anacostia River Church family, welcome this morning as we praise Christ the King. I am Pastor Thabiti Anyabwile. I'm one of the five pastors at Anacostia River Church, and it's my delight to lead us in the service this morning. Let me first begin with a welcome to those of you who are visiting us. Thank you for joining us online for this time of praise and hearing God's word. We want you to feel completely at home. We are a casual bunch. We're a friendly bunch. So jump in the chat on YouTube there and let us know you're here. We would love to greet you. If there's any way we can serve you this week in prayer or other ways, please let us know that too. We would be glad to remember you before the Lord. If you want to learn more about us at church, let me point you to our website at AnacostiaRiverChurch.org. There you'll find more about us and our ministries. We would delight for you to visit us that way as well. Here's, again, what you most need to know about us, though, is that we do not take ourselves seriously, but we do take the gospel of Jesus Christ seriously. It's by that gospel, his death, burial, and resurrection, that we are saved from God's judgment, and we are adopted into God's family, and we have become a family as a local church. And we want you to get in on that. So please lean in to the service this morning. Worship with us, pray with us, listen to God's word with us, and we pray, be edified together with us. Well, church family, there are a couple of announcements I want to bring to your attention this morning. We want to start with the birthdays. We have two birthdays, both of whom happen to be on December the 3rd, that's Thursday, a couple birthday twins. Our sister Sayorsha Anderson will be celebrating her birthday, so show her some love, encourage her. And our sister April Lloyd also will be celebrating her birthday. Likewise, show her some love, encourage her as she celebrates and Sayorsha celebrates another year of God's grace. A couple of announcements I want us to be aware of about our life as a church. On December the 18th, we'll have our next regularly scheduled members meeting. At that members meeting, we hope to present some folks for membership in the church. And we also hope to present to you a draft budget for next year, 2021. In that budget, there will be a couple of recommendations that the pastors want to make to the congregation about job positions and also about affiliations with other churches. So do please pray for that meeting. Come out and let's join together in conducting God's business for us as a family. Also on December the 6th at 4 p.m., the next church planting interest meeting for Congress Heights Christian Church, Community Church, will be held. That's December 6th at 4 p.m. Holler at our brother Joshua about that for more information, more details. Please come out. We were encouraged with the number of people who came out to the last interest meeting. Come out as he continues to cast vision and lay foundation for that work of the Lord among us. Those are our announcements this morning. Why don't we take a moment to quiet our hearts before we hear the call to worship. Sometimes we don't feel invited to things. We feel left out. Someone forgot to mail or email the invitation. Someone forgot to give us a call or drop us a text. Someone forgot to remind us that we were included. And that stings. But how sweet it is to be invited, to be genuinely invited, to be desired, to be called out to and welcomed and included. And that's what the gospel does. That's the invitation of God to come to him, to know him, to experience his love, to be with him, to enjoy his fellowship. And that's what this morning's call to worship does. It invites us. It remembers us. God calls to us in the words of Isaiah 55, verses 1 to 3. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, that your soul may live. and I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. The Spirit and the bride say, come. So come, let's worship Jesus together. Let's enjoy God's love.
We seek to worship you, Lord.
By your stripes, we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands, by his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. Oh,
Hey, ARC family, we are the Whiskers. I'm Christian, this is Russell, and...
I'm Angela, hi, and we are going to talk to you a little bit about what we've been learning through this pandemic season. So, we moved to Anacostia back in June, which has been a really big blessing as we've gotten to know our neighbors and had the opportunity to live and serve missionally. We're really grateful for that. But with our move, we experienced significant disapproval and anger and rejection from our family, and in that was really hard for us as we're working through that. On top of that challenge, we've also experienced division in our family related to politics. We've also had just different health problems within our family members. Whether it's a chronic illness or contracting COVID-19, that's been a rough thing. I'm a teacher, and another challenge has been online learning this season and in desiring to meet the needs of my students, but finding, you know, there are lots of obstacles to achieving that. So at this, you know, season, it's just really felt like a lot of things are outside of our control as we're experiencing this adversity. So yeah, Christian and I have been able to try to find solace and unity with each other and with the Lord through prayer.
Yeah, so while going through all this, these different adversity, these times of adversity, we both had just reached out to our small groups and let them know we were going through it. Through the encouragement of both of those groups, I was with a group of men led by Ken Beats, and Angela's in a small group with a group of ladies led by Ashley and Yemisi. And yeah, they just encouraged us to pray together in the morning, each morning. And yeah, that was a big change for us to make that a daily routine where we wake up and that's how we start our day, is in prayer. And it has just prepared us so well for these times, for these things that are being thrown at us and the spiritual warfare that's happening. It just prepares us so well to give us time to confess our sins to the Lord, to confess our sins to my wife, and for us to air out what we're thinking and how we're feeling, and to give God that control and to let go of the control in times of adversity. I know, at least for myself, is that I try to control and fix. And so having that time each morning with Angela to let God know that I'm going to give him the control of our lives, I'm going to let him lead us during this time, just has been so transformational for us. And talking through these problems and talking through how they affect us. And so, yeah, we just wanted to share with y'all the good news that the Lord is with us through adversity, that He cares about us and wants to love us and wants to lead us and is teaching us valuable lessons through all of this. And yeah, we want to encourage you guys to maybe try to establish something, if you're married with your partner, to have a time to pray together. And if you're not married and you're single, to do this as well, just to have time with the Lord each and every day, to go to Him and to let Him bear our burdens and to ask Him to guide us and lead us. Yeah, thank you, ARC family, for this opportunity to share how the Lord has been moving in our lives and how He's getting us through these rough times. We are praying for you all, and we ask that you pray for us. And we're just so thankful to be a part of this community of saints here, ARC and Anacostia. We love you guys.
Love you.
Bye.
Bye.
Tis so sweet.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the Savior. The Lord.
Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge me 'neath the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that he'll be with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
We trust in you, Lord. Oh, we trust in you.
Oh,
Beloved, the Lord continues to call us to Him, to invite us to come to Him. And coming to Him is not work, it is rest. The best rest we ever find is rest that we take in Christ. The call to come rest is often found in surprising places. One of those places is in the law of God. Sinful man comes to God's law thinking primarily of works and works righteousness. But properly understood, the law is an invitation to rest in God, in all of His goodness, to rest in the society that He provides, a society of perfect righteousness. Christ has fulfilled the law for us, and so we have ceased from our labors. Now we can come to the law and hear an invitation to enjoy what's good. So join me in the reading of God's law in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 1 to 21. And Moses summoned all Israel and said to them, "Hear, O Israel, the statutes and the rules that I speak in your hearing today, and you shall learn them and be careful to do them. The Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb. Not with our fathers did the Lord make this covenant, but with us, who are all of us here alive today. The Lord spoke with you face to face at the mountains, out of the midst of the fire, while I stood between the Lord and you at that time, to declare to you the word of the Lord. For you were afraid because of the fire, and you did not go up into the mountain. He said, 'I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I am the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter or your male servant or your female servant, or your ox or your donkey or any of your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates, that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. Honor your father and your mother as the Lord your God commanded you, that your days may be long, and that it may go well with you in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder, and you shall not commit adultery, and you shall not steal, and you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, and you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, and you shall not desire your neighbor's house, his field, or his male servant, or his female servant, his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's.' These words the Lord spoke to all your assembly at the mountain, out of the midst of the fire, the cloud, and the thick darkness, with a loud voice, and he added no more. And he wrote them on two tablets of stone and gave them to me." Let's pray. Lord God, we praise you as a God who speaks. You are not like the idols made with stone and wood, who have mouths but cannot speak, eyes but cannot see, ears but cannot hear. You are the living God. You are the God who speaks and the entire creation obeys. You are the God whose eyes are running to and fro, watching over the righteous. You are the God with outstretched arm who delivers his people from calamity. And so we praise you, the one true, living, magnificent, brilliant, glorious, beautiful, wonderful God. And we praise you, Lord, for in your commands, you have called us to come to you, to not just obey you, but to rest in you, to find in your word, to find in your rule, that life which really satisfies, that life which fulfills, that life which completes, that life which strengthens. We find it in your word. So we thank you for speaking to us. We thank you for giving us your word. We thank you for bidding us to come to you through faith in you. And Lord, we thank you that you have called us not to be idolaters, but to worship you, the one true and living God. And we pray that as we worship you, we would find a certain kind of rest, Lord. Rest that comes from the harassment of false gods who demand so much and give nothing. Rest from the false promises of idolatry. Promises that are held out and made to appear so enticing, but are empty, even poisonous to the touch and the taste. And so we worship you alone. And we pray, Father, that you would help us as your children. Remember our slavery to sin and that you delivered us through Christ. That you purchased us with his blood and have set us free in him. Free from death, free from sin, free from the penalty of sin, free from the curse of judgment. Thank you for the freedom that you have given us. Enable us to live in that freedom and enable us with that freedom to love others, to serve them, to seek their well-being, to seek justice and mercy and compassion, to seek all the things that you yourself seek for your people and for your creation. Father, we praise you that you have appointed a day of rest for us. Forgive us for so often neglecting it. Even today, we may have plans about what we're going to do as soon as the service is over. And those may be plans that do not include you, plans that do not include fellowship with you and resting with you. Forgive us for making small our appreciation of the gift of rest and fellowship and communion with you. And teach us to rest, to cease from our labors, to cease from self-righteousness, to cease from activity, so that our bodies might be renewed and strengthened, and so that we might be able to persevere in faithfulness to you. So teach us to have Sabbaths, regular Sabbaths, not as a matter of legalism or self-righteousness, but as an opportunity to truly enjoy you and find our souls renewed. We thank you for the gift of parents, Lord. Teach us to honor them. Even in our older age, some of us, let us continue to be respectful of our parents, to care for them, to encourage them, to bless them by our obedience to you and our obedience to them. We thank you for that grace, and we mourn with those who have lost loved ones in this pandemic, Lord. Some have lost parents and grandparents. Some have lost children. We remember the over 250,000 people whose lives were cut short by the virus and complications, health complications that interacted with the virus. Many of them would still be alive today. And so loved ones are left to grieve, to mourn. And we mourn with them and ask, Lord, that you would send your spirit to comfort them. Be the comforter, we pray, in this season. And we pray not just for those who have lost loved ones, but we pray for those who are struggling through various forms of mental health challenges. Isolation, depression, fog and numbness, confusion and hunger for refreshing fellowship, Lord. Many of these things have come upon people. We pray that you would relieve them. We pray that you would comfort them. We pray that you would give biblical counselors special skill in applying your word. We pray that you would give psychiatrists and psychologists expert knowledge of the heart. We pray that family members would be patient and friends would look in on one another, that we might care for each other mentally and spiritually. And that we might be well as we draw near to you by your word. Father, we thank you for the faithfulness of husbands and wives in the congregation, those who have not committed adultery, those who have made a contract with their eyes, a covenant with their eyes, not to look on any unclean thing, nor to look on any clean thing uncleanly. We thank you for the purity of heart that produces faithful commitment in marriage, Lord. And we pray that you would continue to sustain them in that covenant commitment. And we thank you, Lord, for our single members, our celibate members, Lord. We praise you for the self-control that you have given them. Lord, we praise you for the control over desire and thoughts that you have given to them. And we pray that you would stir that more and more. That, Lord, they would continue to honor you with their bodies as well as their thoughts. And Father, we praise you for those who work, supply with their own hands rather than steal. We thank you for the grace, O Lord, that comes from work and the ability to supply our needs and to supply others, O Lord, through work. And we pray that you would bless those who are looking for work or looking for better work. Again, this pandemic has caused unemployment to go through the roof, and so many are disconnected from work. We pray for the hundreds of thousands of women now who have lost their jobs and are disconnected from the workforce. We pray for the hundreds of thousands of men who have suffered likewise. We pray for the young people who were perhaps in part-time jobs or other entry-level employment, that was constructive use of their time, and now are without. Lord, we ask that you would be supplying for them work, that they would be, Lord, again, through that work, renewed as they work as a form of worship of you. Father, we pray, teach us the people who do not covet, but rather seek contentment. Contentment that comes from your word and that comes from knowing you. Contentment that spills out into every area of our life. Grant us what the Apostle Paul discovered, the secret of contentment, knowing how to abound and how to abase, how to have and how to be without, without complaining, without murmuring, without grumbling. Oh, Father, as we have celebrated Thanksgiving over these last few days, Lord, how often have we nonetheless been grumbling and complaining in spirit? Oh, forgive us. When you have been so generous to us, forgive us when we have been so stingy with praise, so stingy with thanks. So teach us to number our days that we might have a heart that fear you. Teach us to number our blessings if we can, so that we might have hearts that praise you. Fill us with gratitude in all things and at all times, we pray. And use us for your glory. In Jesus' name.
Good morning, ARC family and friends. Glad we're all gathered this morning to continue to worship our resurrected Lord and Savior. Hey, I pray you all had a wonderful Thanksgiving. Good time with family and friends, just eating a meal together and fellowshipping together and enjoying your time with one another. Hey, first off, let me give a huge shout out to everyone who participated in serving with Baloo this past Tuesday. By God's grace, through gracious donations from ARC members and some Capitol Hill Baptist church members and then Mercy of Christ Fellowship church members, we were able to serve over 64 families by providing them meals this past Tuesday. So thank you all for your generosity. So grateful for everyone who made a donation or who prayed, and then also who volunteered with us this past Tuesday. So thank you so much once again. I'm really excited to bring God's word this morning. I'm so grateful for the opportunity. As most of you know, we are in a sermon series in the Gospel of Mark entitled Follow Me, Jesus in the Gospel of Mark. So if you have a Bible, and I hope you do, go ahead and turn to Mark chapter 7. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 23 in our time together this morning. And while you're turning there or scrolling there in your mobile devices, let me offer a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this time to gather with the saints online to worship you. We have already been singing praises to you. We have been praying, and now it's time to hear from your word. And so, God, I pray that you would remove any distractions from any of our hearts and minds. Help us to be attentive now to your word. And Holy Spirit, speak and move upon our hearts and help us to obey you. Help us to live in light of your word this morning. And help us to see it as precious. Help us to see your gospel even the more precious this morning. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for calling us together to be your children, to be a family. God, would you bless this time in your word now, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So Mark chapter 7, starting at verse 1, it says, "Now when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, 'Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?' And he said to them, 'Well, did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, "This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men." You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men.' And he said to them, 'You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to establish your tradition. For Moses said, "Honor your father and your mother, and whoever reviles father or mother must surely die." But you say, "If a man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is korban, that is, given to God, then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother, thus making the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you've handed down. And many such things you do." And he called the people to him again and said to them, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him. But the things that come out of a person are what defile him. And when he had entered the house and left the people, his disciples asked him about the parable. And he said to them, "Then are you also without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart but his stomach and is expelled?" Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, "What comes out of a person is what defiles him. For from within, out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." Amen. So if you're taking notes this morning, here is the main idea of this passage. Here it is. Following Jesus produces true heart change, not the traditions or commandments of men. Once again, following Jesus produces true heart change, not the traditions or commandments of men. And from our passage this morning, we'll see three ways that traditions and commandments of men won't produce true heart change, only Jesus. So here they are. Point one. Traditions and commandments of men are rooted in works. And so we'll see that from verses 1 through 4 this morning. Point number 2, traditions and commandments of men elevate themselves over God and his word. And we'll see that in verses 5 through 13 this morning. And then lastly, point number 3, traditions and commandments of men can never change us from within. And so we'll see that from verses 14 through 23 this morning. So point number 1, traditions and commandments of men are rooted in works. Look back with me at verse 1 as it reads. It says, "Now when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands, holding to the traditions of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches." So notice in verse 1 that the Pharisees link up with the scribes that came from Jerusalem to gather with Jesus. They are trying to trap Jesus again. And this has been what they've been trying to do ever since the beginning of Jesus' ministry. They've been trying to trap him. But they didn't have anything on him this time to cast judgment. So what did they do? Well, they go after those who are close to him, his disciples. And so they judge the disciples based on their standard of living. They judge the disciples based on their standard of living. And so the question for us this morning is, have you and I ever done this before? Have we judged people based on our standards of living? So you got to remember that the Pharisees were self-righteous, and they compared their way of living to everyone else around them. Look back with me at verse 2. And so it says, "They saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed." Notice that the text says they saw some of Jesus' disciples, not all. And what's ironic is that they were able to cast judgment on all based on a few. So what did they see? They saw some of the disciples eating with unwashed hands. And if you check out the CSB translation, you'll learn that they were eating bread. So they were eating bread with unwashed hands. And the Pharisees use a strong word to describe their unwashed hands, that word being defiled. So defiled in this context means that the disciples' hands were profaned, violated, and unclean. And so I know right now we're in the pandemic and we're all thoroughly washing our hands and wearing masks and social distancing, and rightly so, we should be. But just imagine for a second, if me and my family had you over for dinner, and you know, let's say Thanksgiving dinner, and we are about to eat the meal, and my wife and my son, we have all washed our hands, and we're about to eat, but as we were about to start eating, we noticed that you didn't wash your hands. Now, for one, we're going to need you to wash them hands. but what if we called you defiled for not washing them? What if we judged you for not washing them the way that we should, or the way that we thought you should? Then you might think that there's a little bit more into the whole washing of your hands at the Rolex. You would think that there's something else going on, like why are they washing their hands so much during this time? And why are they judging me based on the way that I wash or not wash my hands? Well, this is exactly what's going on in this passage. If you look back at verse 3, the word used for wash there is a ceremonial wash. And so what this means is that the Pharisees and the Jews were expected to wash their hands, but not for hygiene's sake. It was more in a ritualistic sense. So if they were eating a lengthy meal, then they would wash their hands several times during the course of that meal. And then in verse 4, we see that after they leave the marketplace, that they don't eat unless they wash their hands. So one scholar says that a full immersion of the body is in view here. So baptism. So they come from the marketplace and they are fully immersing themselves in water, wanting to clean themselves up. They even wash all of their dishes and furniture in a ritualistic sense. So where am I going with all of this? Well, it's that the Pharisees and the Jews had a different definition of what it meant to be clean in God's sight. They had a whole different understanding of the standard of holiness. They didn't view themselves as unclean because they kept up their ceremonial washings, the routines of that. And so in other words, the Pharisees were caught up in works-based salvation. They thought that they could be saved by what they do for God. So what about you this morning? What about you? If you're not a Christian, we're so glad that you're tuning in this morning with us at Anacostia River Church. If you're not a Christian, I don't think it's by chance that you've been worshiping with us, singing songs and praying and hearing the word preached now. I don't think it's by chance that you're here with us this morning. But if you check out in the rest of the sermon, and if you don't hear anything else that I say right now, I want you to hear this, that you cannot save yourself. That nothing you attempt to do, try to do, will do, can save yourself. The only way that you can be saved is by the person and work of Jesus Christ. See, the reality for you and for me and for all of us is that we are sinners and that we are separated from God apart from Christ. And that because of our sin, we deserve God's righteous judgment due to sinners and eternity separated from Him because of our sin. But Jesus, who is God, comes and He lives a perfect sinless life in your place and in my place. And He dies a death that you and I deserve on the cross for our sin. And He's buried in a grave for 3 days. And on that third day, He rose. And His resurrection is proof to God that the sacrifice of Jesus was accepted. And through His life, His death, His burial and resurrection, He offers life to you and I, salvation. And so I want to invite you to that this morning. Don't rely on your works. They won't save you. Rely solely on Christ and His work in your place for your sin. And if you're a Christian this morning, praise God. Amen. Thanks be to God that you have received Christ by faith through grace. I want to encourage you to not take that for granted, to be reminded that you are only saved by His grace through faith. I'm reminded of Ephesians 2, verse 8 through 9 here, where it says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast." And I want to encourage you this morning, Christian, keep looking to Jesus. Keep looking to Jesus, Christian. So not only are traditions and commandments of men rooted in works, but traditions and commandments of men elevate themselves over God and His word. So point number two, traditions and commandments of men elevate themselves over God and His word. Look back at verse 5 with me, as you'll see that the Pharisees and the scribes ask a question. It says, "And the Pharisees and the scribes ask Him, why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands? Notice the content of this question and what's elevated. Do you see it? Do you see that the tradition of the elders is what's being elevated here? You also see it mentioned in verse 3 and verse 5 and a few other places in this passage. So what's going on here is that the tradition of the elders, which is the oral tradition, has been elevated higher than God's word. One scholar puts it this way in speaking on the tradition of the elders. He says, the contention between Jesus and the Pharisees over clean and unclean was, however, only symptomatic of a deeper cleavage, the crux of which concerned the tradition of the elders. Then he continues to say, he says, in distinction from the Sadducees, for whom the written law of the Torah alone was authoritative, Pharisees accepted the evolving oral law as equally authoritative. Do you see that there? That the Pharisees and the scribes are viewing the traditions of the elders as authoritative over God's word. So how does Jesus respond to this? Well, he doesn't respond too well, huh? First off, he calls them hypocrites. We call that faking in the hood or fronting. Them fighting words right there, you know. But Jesus then quotes a prophecy from Isaiah 29:13. And here's what it reads. It says, and the Lord said, because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their fear of me is a commandment taught by men. So the Pharisees live hypocritically by honoring God with their lips, but their hearts are far from him. They offer lip service while their hearts are in a whole other country, far away. And if we as believers are not careful, we can slip into that same practice. Maybe not in the same sense of the Pharisees and the scribes right now in the text. Maybe not in that same sense. But if we're not careful, we can find ourselves praising God with our lips while we tune into an online service, but our hearts not being close to God. Maybe there's some unrepentant sin, or maybe we haven't been in God's word or in prayer as much this week, spending time, intimate time with God this week. Or maybe we're distracted by everything else that's going on in the world and not attentive to our souls in the way that we should be. So I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, to not get caught up in lip service like the Pharisees and the scribes. We want to worship God rightly. We want to worship him in the way that he intended for us to worship him. So let's do that, Christians. So not only do the Pharisees honor God with their lips while their hearts are far away, they also worship in vain and teach the commandments of men as if they're doctrine. Now, this is very problematic. So at the core is what the oral tradition is all about, is that they, the Pharisees teach traditions and commandments of men as doctrine. So what's happening here is that they are teaching the traditions and commandments of men as if they're core teachings of the faith when they are not. So this is very troubling to take the washing of hands or any other traditions or commandments that are man-made and to then teach them as if they are scripture, as if they are core teachings of the Christian faith. This is not how we are to handle God's word. This is not how we are to mix up traditions and commandments of men with God's word. May we not be known for that, ARC. May we not be known for mixing up traditions or commandments of men and teaching them as doctrines. So in doing so, they leave the commandment of God and hold to their tradition. You see that in verse 8. And then in verse 9, they reject the commandment of God in order to establish their tradition. Jesus gives them an example of this with how they handled the commandment from God to honor their father and mother, found in Exodus 20, verse 12, as it reads, it says, "Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you." And then from Exodus 21, 17, quotes another verse. He says, "Whoever curses his father or his mother shall be put to death." But what do the Pharisees do with that? The Pharisees elevate their word above God's holy word and then says something completely different. Look back at verse 11. What does it say? It says, in Jesus talking with them, he says, "But you say, if a man tells his father or his mother, whatever you would have gained from me is Corban, that is given to God, then you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother." Do you see what's going on here? That word Corban is a Hebrew word, which means an offering or gift dedicated to God. And so Dr. Danny Aiken at Southeastern Seminary helps us understand what this word means. He says the word Corban allowed them, the Pharisees, to dishonor their parents by neglecting their needs, but still feel good about it because it was done in service to God. The Pharisees and the scribes completely changed what God intended in his word when he commanded us to honor our father and our mother. They completely changed it by then allowing them and others to dishonor their parents by neglecting their needs, but to still feel good about it, as it's done in service to God. Now, how messed up and how wicked is that? That's not what God desires for us. We are to honor our mother and our father, because in honoring our mother and father, we are honoring what God has commanded us to do. And so the result of their misalignment of tradition makes the word of God void. See that in verse 13, what does it say? "Thus making the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down." Thus making void the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. And many such things you do. So it makes it void. It cancels it out. So traditions and commandments of men elevate themselves over God and his word. Now let's look at the last point. Traditions and commandments of men can never change us from within. So traditions and commandments of men can never change us from within. We see that in verses 14 through 23. Look back with me. So in verse 14, Jesus calls the people to him again, and he said to them, so it's almost like Jesus is having a come to Jesus moment with everyone who is around. And he tells them all a parable in verse 15. So he says, "Hear me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going into him can defile him. But the things that come out of a person are what defile him." So he tells them this parable, and if you're reading in the ESV, you'll notice that we don't have a verse 16 here, but there is a footnote, which just tells us that some manuscripts add in this verse, "If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear." So the disciples don't understand the meaning of verse 17, so Jesus explains it to them in verses 18 through 23. And so if you look back with me in verse 18, it says, and he said to them, then are you also without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile him, since it enters not his heart, but his stomach and is expelled? Thus he declared all foods clean. So it's not what goes into us, right? It's what comes out of us that's unclean, that's defiled, from what Jesus says here. And what are those things that come out of us? Well, he says in verse 20, what comes out of a person is what defiles him. And here are those things. For from within, out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. So it's not about the eating of bread and with unwashed hands or anything along those lines that makes us unclean. Jesus unveils a more important and bigger issue for us this morning. It's that our hearts are defiled. It's that our hearts are unclean. And it's that all of our hearts, apart from Christ, are defiled and wicked. In Jeremiah 17:9, in talking about the heart, says this: the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? So that's you and I. Our hearts are wicked, fam. They're wicked. And so what's the remedy for a defiled, deceitful, and wicked heart? What's the remedy for that? Well, the remedy is that we need a new one. We need a new heart. You can't clean yourself up. You know, the Pharisees and the scribes thought they could, but the reality of it is that none of us can clean ourselves up. They thought that if they did enough works, if they washed their hands or pots and all of those different things, that they thought that would make them right with God. And the reality of it is it won't. As you remember earlier, me just mentioning, there is nothing that you can do that can save you. So it doesn't matter what works you and I muster up, none of those works can save us. Only the work of Christ can save us. And so some of you listening this morning, you're functioning like the Pharisees. You're functioning, thinking as if your works will save you. And I want to encourage you to not believe that lie. To not believe the lie that your works will save you. The reality is we all need the promise of Ezekiel 36 realized in our lives. That's the reality, that we need the promise of Ezekiel 36. And it reads this, it says, starting in verse 25, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleannesses. And from all your idols, I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. So that's the reality this morning, is that we all need new hearts. And if you're a Christian this morning, by God's grace, God has actualized this promise already in your life and in my life through the person and work of his son. But if you're not a Christian this morning, I want you to lean in and I want you to hear me in love this morning. Is that the reality is if you die in your sins, that you will be eternally separated from a loving God who desires that you know him. And he has made a way for you to know him. And that's through his son, Jesus Christ, who offered his life as a sacrifice, fully paid your sin debt and my sin debt so that we might be with God for all of eternity. I want to invite you this morning to not harden your heart, but to allow God, by his Spirit, through the gospel, to soften your heart, to give you a new heart and a new mind, and cause you to walk in his way. I want to invite you to repent. See, the word repent is just a biblical word that means to turn away from all of the sin that God hates and to turn to him, Jesus, in faith, in belief, solely in him. Meaning putting all of your eggs in that basket. Relying solely upon what Christ has done for you in your place. I want to invite you to repent and to turn to him, and to trust him, and let him change your life and cause you to walk in the way that he intended for you to walk this morning. So I want to invite you to that and encourage you to not think twice about that, to not delay, but to do it now. Trust him. He is coming back soon, and you want to be found ready when he comes. And brothers and sisters who have already trusted in Christ, keep trusting. Keep relying on him. Don't let the works or anything else tempt you to think that you can do it in your own strength. No, you need God's strength. You need the gospel day in and day out. We all do. We never outgrow our need for the gospel. And so take comfort in that. Be encouraged in that. Be revived in that this morning. That the good news was good news when you first heard it and responded by faith and repentance in Christ. But it's good news now. It's good news this morning. And you can bank on that. So as we come to a close, I want to just encourage you to sink in the gospel, to bear hug the gospel this morning. It's our only hope. Rely upon Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we do praise you for your word this morning. We do thank you for the beauty of your word, the preciousness of your word, the gift of your word that you have given to us, that you have revealed to us through your Son. Thank you, God, that you've saved us, that you have not left us alone in our sin or in our own ways to try to figure it out, but that you've provided all that we need in Christ for life and godliness. Thank you that we have been granted the gift of faith and repentance. Thank you that you have given us your Spirit. Thank you that we are known by you and that you know us. So God, this morning I pray that we would all be encouraged in this Thanksgiving season, that we would have hearts of gratitude this season. And I pray for all who tuned in, who are unsure where they are spiritually, or who are on the fence, God, I pray that you would save them, that you would draw them to yourself, that they would see their need for you, and that they would see that they can't do anything in their own strength to save themselves, but that you have provided a Savior, Jesus. And so we worship you this morning, and we praise you, God, and we thank you for all that you're doing in our lives and that you will do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's sing of our Savior who has saved us. His blood cleanses us, and it never fails us. His blood is what saves us. Amen. Let's start with the chorus. It says, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Sing, oh, precious.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Well, Well, family, praise God for the blood of Christ by which we are saved. This morning, during our time, we've been worshiping the Lord Jesus for what he's done for us. And we know that only he can provide the true heart change that we so desperately need. And so now hear the blessing of the Lord. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.